The fourth of the 11 games I recorded during my Switch Online free trial, Tough Enough, or Dead Dance in Japan. This is a game I vaguely remember the name of. I probably saw it in some over a decade old YouTube video talking about obscure Super Nintendo games, or its US box art on a list of the worst ever. But apart from that, I knew pretty much nothing about this game, apart from one little thing I'll get to much later. It's all set in the year 2151, on a post-apocalyptic Earth ravaged by war. In the ruins, a man named Jade rose up. After finding a powerful suit of armour and dubbing himself the Fighting King, in a world now ruled by the survival of the fittest, Jade manages to take control. He erects a massive tower in the ruins of a city and fills it with six powerful guards. Many try to take on Jade for his power, none live. A few weeks later, Jade holds a tournament to determine those who are powerful enough to face him. From across the remaining countries in the world, only four are chosen. They must first fight amongst themselves at the bottom of the tower, then they have to get through Jade's guards before reaching the man himself. There's a bit more plot on characterization, but much of it was scrapped in the localization, including all post-match dialogue and even all the endings. As for gameplay, it is a very standard Street Fighter 2 clone for the time. We have two punch and two kick buttons along with special moves done with the usual command inputs. It's a decent enough speed and I found the game mostly responsive with the special moves. What did take a bit to get used to was the hit stun. Whenever someone gets hit, there's a split second freeze, I guess to sell the impact. At first, it really threw off my rhythm, but I eventually got used to it. There's also a cool little replay feature at the end of the round you can mess around with to see the killing blowback. That's about it, so let's get into these characters. There are 11 characters in the game, but only the 4 tournament winners can be played as in the single player. And even past that, the other 7 require a cheat code that differs in every region to be unlocked in multiplayer. First we have Sho. Sho practices Yamete, a secret martial art. He had a rivalry with his childhood friend Zazie, but their competition was put on hold when the war began and the world was ruined. He wants to remove Jade from power to bring peace back to the war-torn world, and also settle his rivalry with Zazie. He has the Seireiken, a standard Hadouken clone with a quarter circle forward and punch. He's got a Shoryuken type, the Sokoha, with back, down, forward and punch. Then there's the Ryugekiha with charge forward, down, back and punch. Sho feels like a standard 90s fighting game protagonist, both in terms of gameplay and appearance, though it takes more inspiration visually from Kenshiro of Fist of the North Star than Ryu. He just lacks the Tatsumaki Senpukyak stand-in, which actually harms him because the movie has in its place just does not feel worth the pain it is to make it happen. He's not the most interesting character in the game, but he's far from the worst. Next we have that childhood friend and rival of Sho's, Zazie. Zazie practices the same art, but in a different form at a different school. Unlike his altruistic rival, Zazie is rude and unfriendly, which I would have known while playing if the post-fight dialogue hadn't been cut. His aspirations for when Jade is dethroned are less than noble. Zazie is a heads-up of Sho, making him the Ken of the series. That just right series, the game wasn't that lucky. He's the Ken of the game. I guess making the head swap bald and changing the skin colour is a more creative way of making your Ken. That also means his moves are exactly the same as Sho's. I'm fine with clones and head swaps in fighting games, but in this case it is a bit of a problem since your unique moveset count for the single player is not 4, but 3. It seems he was one of the bigger victims of the game cutting dialogue, as he is very vulgar and nasty towards his opponents in Japanese. It would definitely make him stand out more than he does in the localization. The third tournament winner is Kotono. She's a ninja out for revenge against Jade, who killed her father. That's all I could find on her. She can throw her kunai with charge back forward and punch. There's her spiral cutter with back forward kick, and swift slice with quarter circle back and punch. Kotono is a charge character, so more than any of the other three, I had trouble pulling off her specials. But eventually, when it came to dealing with the AI, I found trapping them in the corner with her punch and crouching strong kick worked well on enough of them. As for the character, it feels they decided to combine the two big fighting game women at the time. She's a ninja like Mai Shiranui, with the revenge for father killing motivation of Chun-Li. Apparently in Japanese, the post-fight dialogue has everyone in the cast act misogynistic towards her and put her down over being a woman, even by Sho, our supposed hero. But only her, the other woman on the roster gets none of it. My guess is that because you only play as Kotono in story mode out of the two, it was an attempt to give off a more oppressive atmosphere to make it more satisfying as you ascend the tower and beat the faces in. But overall, she's fine. Really, no one in this game is anything more than fine. At best, they fill their roles well, but they haven't had a chance to be expanded past that with this being the only game. Our final protagonist is Vorse. Vorse is known as the King of Beasts, and is present in search of somebody, though nobody else knows who. He's usually very quiet and doesn't talk much in the Japanese version, meaning he isn't one for the insults, being the only one to not give Kotono shit for being a woman. though there is one boss he'll throw out of a trash talk with. He has his buffalo charge of charge back, forward and kick. Rising buffalo is quad circle forward and punch. Muscle buster is half circle forward and punch while up close. Being the big, slow grappler means at first I had a bit of trouble with Vorts, my attempts at getting in resulting in taking a hit. But then a few matches in, I discovered a valuable strategy. Screw the special moves, get up close, pin the opponent in the corner and just mash kick. Vorts has a throw that has him repeatedly stamp on the opponent's head. Once I got them there, they could not escape, since as soon as they get back up, they get a kick and then get stamped back down again. It made Vorts' playthrough by far the quickest. Vorts is okay. It's interesting that the wrestler is the quiet one at least, since they're usually the ones with the big personalities. There's the main Thor. You must first defeat the other three before you go on to enter the tower. These first three fights are all set in a sports stadium, just outside the tower. It's an okay stage, few unhealthy dust, fog and empty stands help sell the shitty world they're living in. And we get a tease of the tower through the hole in the back wall. All of the main Thor get their own themes. Kotono's and Zazie's are fine, while Shaw's and Vorts' are pretty good. Once they're defeated, I get to go up to the tower to take on Jade's six guards, always in the same order. Starting with Beans. As said before, you can play as all seven bosses through a cheat code, but only in the versus mode. Beans is a street fighting champion from the Bronx. That's about it for what we get on him. For some reason, he's the only character Vorts will trash talk in the Japanese version, so it makes you wonder what he did. He's got dynamite punches with charge back, forward and heavy punch, and the Emperor Sting with quarter circle back to down and heavy kick. The bosses tend to have more limited movesets than the main characters. Beans is strange. The game is Fist of the North Star inspired, and he very much looks like a henchman from that series with the face paint, the big shoulders and the hair, and yet he does look like he's from a different game. It took me a long time to realise that was a brace around his head too, I thought it was a goofy mustache. But he's also the first boss, so the weird guy who looks out of place with the strange mannerisms being the lowest in the hierarchy fits too. He's not bad though, definitely not the worst character in the game. His stage shows us at the bottom of the tower, with these two massive statues guarding the door. Knowing the Fist of the North Star inspiration, these statues and their positioning make me think of Raiga and Fuga, those twins who die holding up the massive ceiling while being tortured to death. He's got one of the better themes in the game too. The second guard is Dolph. He used to be a military commander in Libya, but after the war ruined the world, he now acts as a mercenary. He fights while holding a knife and a rocket launcher. He's got the bazooka blast with charge back, forward and heavy punch, and the blast knee with heavy kick while in the air. There's always a former military guy in these villain groups, and the thing that stands out about Dolph is his stage. Considering there was a nuclear war in the last couple of years, who went and gave this guy a room full of nukes? The music is also way too upbeat and hopeful for this combination of character and stage. Apart from that, there isn't much to say about Dolph, except for how his name is not Libyan. That's about it. The third guard is Rei Mizuno, the only character in the game with a surname. The only bit of story I can find on her is that she is a magician. I thought all the glowing hands and special moves were chi, but I guess in her case it may be all illusions. She's got quite a few moves for her boss, more than even most of the main characters. She has ground flame with quarter circle forward and light punch. Deadly vortex is done with quarter circle forward and heavy punch. Hidden dragon with charge down forward, forward and heavy punch. Finally, tremor uppercut with charge down forward, back and heavy punch. At first, I didn't have that much to say about Rei. She seemed like a traditional martial artist with fighting game chi powers. But if the part about her being a magician is true, and all these special moves are illusions and such, she's become a lot more interesting. It means she's managed to fake her way up to being the third guard, above the guy with a room of nukes. Of course, she has to be a capable fighter otherwise, and it's just the moves that are fake. But if true, that really added something to a character I wouldn't have had much of an opinion on, if any. What I do have an opinion on is that her stage is pretty cool, with all the smoke from the millions of candles floating across the screen. Her theme is also my favourite music track in the game. The fourth guard is Gadget. He was a wrestler before the war who accidentally killed an opponent, resulting in his banning from the sport. It wasn't a total loss for him though, since the experience resulted in him discovering that he really liked killing. He's believed to be a former friend of Vorts, which leads one to assume he's the one Vorts is looking for. But once again, thanks to endings being cut in the localization, the answer to that mystery is lost outside of Japan. Speaking of Vorts, Gadget is a heads-up of him, being put in a mask instead. He has Vorts' normals and one of his specials, the Rising Buffalo. He does have a move of his own, the Frankensteiner, with half circle forward and heavy kick while up close. Gadget makes me think that Vorts was the developer favourite, as there's more detail put into his story and relationships than any other. Even before the big reveal, they hint at a pass between these two when Vorts has a unique victory pose against Gadget where he just looks down in sadness. He has another of the better themes and I quite like his stage, a balcony overlooking the ruins of the city the tower was built in, getting to see the devastation to sell the miserable world these people live in. After Gadget, we have Shiro. He's a ninja with a sword. That's all the story he has. He has one special move, the ground wave with quarter circle forward and heavy punch. I found Shiro the least memorable character in the game, to the point that between playing the game and coming back to write this video, I'd forgotten about him. He's a bit of a pain when controlled by the AI thanks to the range of some of his sword attacks, but that's it. He just feels a bit out of place alongside the rest of these rough and grimy fighters or con artists. The ninja somehow feels too normal. That doesn't mean he's my least favourite though. Even his stage feels like it could come from any game and doesn't need to be part of the tower. Top 3 theme music though. After Shiro, the 6th and final guard is Kaze. His story is that he is a cyborg, but we can tell that by looking at him. His moves are the lightning storm with half circle forward and heavy punch, and the steel pounce with charge back, quarter circle forward and heavy punch. The latter I could never pull off myself. Kaze is my least favourite character in the game because I think his design is dumb. It's those cyborg arms, they're too long. Not too long in an off-putting body horror way. Too long in a, oh we fucked up and now the arms look awkward way. If the rest of his design was better, he might be able to get away with it. But a pair of orange jeans and nothing else, not even the shoes, isn't it? Decent theme music, okay stage. That's the last of the guards, and after him, you reach the top of the tower to take on Jade himself. His backstory is the plot of the game, and I've already explained that, so it's onto his moves. An interesting thing about Jade is that while he has attacks used by holding down, he's actually incapable of crouching. His standing heavy punch is the blast wave. Skyward blast is quarter circle back and heavy punch. Plasma ball is charged down back, forward and heavy punch. Sonic Knee is done in the air with back or forward and heavy kick. So now for the thing I remembered that I mentioned at the start. The whole time playing the game, I was looking at Jade and he seemed so familiar, but I just couldn't place him. Then I remembered. Back in 2006-2007, I was very into messing about with Mugen and watching YouTube videos on it. Jade's sprites were the basis of the character Cheap Boss Type. I remembered that character name, but not what he looked like, and now that whole memory is complete again. Based on the 8 volumes of the newer release of Fist of the North Star I've read, I can feel the inspiration from Souther, with the building of the massive tower and declaring himself a god. He's definitely intimidating enough compared to everyone else and fitting for the final boss. But I must say, the top of this tower is kind of the bland stage and doesn't have quite the atmosphere of the final battle I was hoping for. His theme music is also my least favourite character theme in the game, so that's a shame. All that's left is to defeat him. In Japanese, you get a congratulations screen unless you finish the game on hard. Elsewhere, you get a congratulations screen and nothing else regardless of difficulty, so a balls to hard mode on this version. But for the endings we lost, Sho defeats Jade and intends to continue his fight against evil, travelling the world and beating up bandits. Zazie defeating Jade makes him realise that he has no equal, and so he decides to rule the remains of the world himself. He basically becomes Rao, complete with the horse. Kotono feels her father must be at peace with his death avenged. She then returns to her training, determined to carry on her father's legacy as a Master Shinobi. Meanwhile, Vorts feels that the battle was in vain, as he could not save Gadget, who was revealed to actually be his younger brother. He's proven to be mistaken though, as the beating Vorts gave Gadget made him realise that power won't be enough to restore the world. And so they work together and pass their techniques down to children, in the mistaken belief that wrestling moves can undo the effects of nuclear war. I'll fucking chokeslam that nuclear fallout, just you watch! Tough Enough is far from one of the better fighting games I've ever played, but I wouldn't call it bad. Decent for its time, and better than I was expecting. There are far worse fighting games on the Super Nintendo alone, some of which I've covered. I definitely like this game more than Super Butoh M1 and the SNES port of Fatal Fury. It tried to set itself apart from other Street Fighter 2 clones at the time by skipping the worldwide setting, and going for the more contained Tower and a Fist of the North Star inspired Misery world. It was more unique than I expected and the gameplay was also faster and more responsive than I was expecting. It's just a shame the localization took a chainsaw to a lot of the characterization. Once again, far from the best, but you could do much, much worse.